You have your calculator with you?
Oh, yeah.
You can push the buttons.
Times what?
Yeah, 2.5 cubic inches for every time it goes around once, so it's going to go around 120 times.
That's 300.
So that comes out 300, doesn't it? Is it 300?
Yeah, 120 times 2.5.
That's correct. This was already on?
Yeah, I turned it on.
Sorry, okay. So I'm sorry, getting sidetracked here, too many things going on. Let me get rid of this just for a second. So this comes out to be 200, what did you say, I'm sorry?
300.
300 even?
Yes.
300 what?
300 inches.
Inches cubed, that's cubic inches. In how long? In a minute, right?
Yeah.
In a minute, because that's revolutions per minute. So actually, we stretch it, that's cubic inches for every revolution, revolutions per minute. You can see that the revolutions cancel, I end up with cubic inches in a minute. So this is the number of cubic inches in a minute. We can write it per minute if you want, or we can just keep in mind that we're only going to talk about 1 minute and just leave it as cubic inches. So this becomes the volume, doesn't it? In this problem, in a 1 minute cycle, we know there's this pressure drop, and we know now that there's 300 cubic inches of volume being moved. And since this is an open system, we know that we're going to use the equation that's right on the board, that the fluid work is the negative of the pressure drop times that volume. Pressure drop 75. Let's just keep going. Maybe we don't have to do so much change. Although they want it in foot pounds, maybe we're better off, because I see cubic inches, I see square inches, don't you? So I'm going to keep this inches thing and see, maybe at the end I'll change it. You might change it now, but you know, I don't like to make a lot of changes until I come to the end result. So let's see. Volume now is 300 cubic inches total in a minute. Well, the negative of whatever that all turns out to be will be the work done by the fluid. And say, well, why is this going to come out negative? Another question you might ask. Because when the pump is doing work on the fluid, then the fluid is doing negative work. It's receiving work, if you will, instead of giving out work or doing work. So that's what that negative sign means. How important is it? Well, we talked about it last class. We'll talk about it some more during this class as well. What's the answer to the question here then? 75 times 300, and what do I get for units of measure? So let's do the math first. 3 times 75. That's 225?
Yeah.
And then how many zeros here we got?
Two.
So 2,500 looks like.
Well, 225. 2,200.
2,225. Is that what you get on your calculator?
No, 2,250.
2,250. Is that correct? I don't have my calculator in front of me, so I'm asking you guys to help me. Is that the answer you got?
Yeah, with another zero.
22,000. Because let's see, 300 times 70, 2,100 times 70 is 22,500. Does that sound right?
Yeah, that's what I got.
Okay, you get that too? Okay, so that's going to come out in what units of measure? Well, let's try it. I got pounds is on top. Is that on top or on the bottom? Is that a numerator or a denominator when it stands alone?
Numerator.
It's a numerator. You know, you got to know these little things. I mean, it's obviously, you can put it over one if you want to. Now, I can see where my crisscross thing is. Okay, this is times. We know it's times. So what happens to inches cubed and inches squared?
It just goes to inches up the top.
Yeah. In other words, two of the inches can cancel, but one of them won't, right?
Mm-hmm.
You guys good with that? Okay, inches squared, inches cubed. I mean, inches cubed can be written as inches squared times inches to the first. So that would be inches cubed. But so I take out two of them, and I'm left with one. When I take out the two, I'm left with one. So that's the reduction. Now I'm down to units of measure that make some sense to me, pounds and inches. So I'm at inch pounds, am I not? Inch pounds or pound inches, however you want to say them. I'm not saying per, because it's multiplied. They're side by side, inches times pounds. Well, they want it in feet times pounds. Well, now it's a simple conversion, isn't it? What's the only thing you got to convert? If you have inch pounds, you can go to foot pounds. You just got to convert the
foot and the inches
thing, right? And you can do that using that same format we've been using as we continue to go along. So we have an answer to the work in inch pounds. Now we want to do it in foot pounds. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to do a little side calculation. If I want foot pounds, that's what I want. I don't know how many yet, but I'm going to know in a few minutes. And I already have the number of inch pounds, then what do I do? And notice that, you know, inch pounds, again, they're side by side. They're not one over the other. So see some confusion. You have a little confusion about whether when units are one over the other as opposed to side by side, work units and so forth. So what's a proper work unit? If it shows up as feet over pounds, you're going to call that a work unit?
No.
The answer is no, you don't want to call that because it's force times distance, isn't it? No, it's side by side, not one over the other. Very important to make a distinction. When we read two things side by side, we say foot pounds. If it was going to be something over, something, say per, foot per pound or whatever, a pound per square inch. So we have a different way of saying it, we have a different way of writing it, and a different way of calculating it. That means divide, this means multiply. So we have to keep those things consistent. Okay, sorry again for that little sidetrack, but so now we're going to go ahead. How do I get rid of it? What would I like to get rid of here?
You want to get rid of the inches?
Get rid of the inches. I put it on the bottom because that's on the top. That'll help me cancel it out. What would I like to put on the top?
Pounds. Feet.
Pounds is already on the top. I'd like to put feet on the top. Then I can get rid of inches. Now what's left on the top? Feet times pounds. Foot pounds. That's what I want. So if I know the answer for the inch pounds is 22,500, which you can write as a power of 10 if you could say 2.25 times 10 to the fourth if you wanted to. Well, you could write it that way. And then here it's 12 inches, 1 foot. So 22,500 divided by 12 will be the answer you need for the foot pound work there, right? So what are the things that keep us from being able to do those kinds of things? Well, largely, it's getting the right equation again. And then once you get the equation, looking for how do I get the answers. This RPM thing was a little confusing, but boy, you did a good job. When I asked the question right off the bat, you knew it. So try to think it through yourself. Say, you know, this is a volume. This thing's going around. It's delivering 2.5 cubic inches every one revolution. Then it tells you 120 revolutions per minute. You had to do something about that to get the total volume.
Right. So that is the answer? 1875?
For the how much work in foot-pounds, yes sir, 1875 is the answer.
Okay.
Can we do it in a second?
Well, that's what 11 is, it's the horsepower one.
Yeah, wait a minute, there's another part to 10. How much fluid work in a minute? Now they ask how much work in foot-pounds in a second. Well, if you know how much in a minute, what do you do to get them out in a second?
Divided by 60.
Simple enough, right? Simple enough. Divided by 60, you get the second half of that answer. That comes out about 31 something.
31.2?
Yeah.
Then once you know it per second, you can find the horsepower.
If you know per second, that's what a horsepower is defined as, foot pounds in a second. So the question is,
so then it would be
that's the number of foot pounds in a second is called power. So let's just take a look at that.
It's horsepower, right?
It's called power. Foot pounds per second is power. So it's, and we'll learn more.
It's 550.
It's five, but when you have units of 550 foot pounds for every 1 second, every one of those 550s is called 1 horsepower. But foot-pounds per second is a power. That's a power. The only difference is it's work done in a certain time. Example, two weightlifters, me and this big horse over here, right? And I can lift 200 pounds in a clean and jerk, but I'm struggling. You know, I finally get it up there, okay? So I did the same amount of work he's gonna do, but he does it. So I'm still halfway working the thing up and he's already done. Who did more work? Be careful.
Same amount of work.
Because we both lifted the same weight the same distance. Who had more power?
He did.
He did because he did that same amount of work in a shorter time. That's coming up in another chapter. That's a chapter on rate, so we're not really studying it.
So is that like obviously like in a truck pull or something like that, you got like a big 350, but then you got like a little truck. The little truck can do it. It just
takes longer. That's what power is, the rate at which you do work. And that's not the lesson in this chapter, but it's just thrown in there as a little extra to get you thinking about what's coming up in a chapter after next. We start studying rate.
So
how much was our answer in foot-pounds in a second? You took the final answer we got and divided by 60. What did you end up with?
31.2.
So you have 31.2 foot-pounds per second. Okay. If you have the conversion, it says that 550 foot-pounds in a second is equal to 1 horsepower, then you can do the same thing you do every time. Take the units you want and convert them. So you already have foot-pounds per second, don't you? 31.2. What would you like to get rid of? I'd like to get rid of foot-pounds per second, and I'd like to have horsepower in its place. Do you see that? So this is the number in foot-pounds per second. This is getting a little converted, but I'll just take the whole thing.
Times that by 550.
That's right. So it comes right down to this. Foot-pounds per second on the bottom, right? And I'm keeping it all whole so I can get rid of this from here and in place horsepower. And the 1 horsepower is 550, and you have to divide that by 550 to get, not multiply.
Why is there a 5 on the bottom?
It's not. It's an S. It's per second. I'm sorry.
Oh.
Per second. So it ends up when I want to get rid of the foot-pounds per second, which is what the answer I have is in foot-pounds. If I want to get rid of that and change the horsepower, 1 horsepower is 550. So this ends up being this divided by 550. Because it takes 550 to make 1 horsepower. I don't have 1 horsepower. I have less than 1 horsepower, considerably less than 1 horsepower. So it's a divide problem, isn't it? When you know how many foot-pounds per second you have, you divide by the 550. There's the proof.
You do 31.2 divided by 550, not times it.
That's what I was trying to prove to you here. How did I know that? Because I was getting rid of the foot-pounds per second and changing it to horsepower. The conversion factor says 1 with the horsepower, 550 down here, so that means it divide. And you know that's not 1 horsepower. If I was multiplying, I'd have this huge number of horsepower. That's not much power.
If you were timesing it, it would be 31.2 horsepower.
No. It would be 31. I don't know what you mean by if I was multiplying. You wouldn't multiply, first of all.
Yeah.
So, but if you did, it would be.
So then it's 0.056.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And sometimes.
So it's not even. It's half a horsepower.
No, because no. 31.2. It takes 550 of them 1 horsepower.
Yeah, you.
1.2 isn't even close to.
So 550 is what we call 1 horsepower. You only have 30. If you have 30 compared to 5, you only have a small fraction of that horsepower. So you can see it's a divide problem. And again, that's not the main lesson, but it's a good plant the seed now for what's coming up in the next chapter. You start to begin to connect the dots a little bit. Did you want to do more review of these problems? Well, you want me to make answer sheets or print these? I was going to do that, and I got sidetracked with this stupid computer stuff. Go over them.
I mean, the answers help, but
yeah, they're not telling you the.
When you see it,
I know. Like I'm with you. And if they're making sense, I'm feeling really good about that because I'm seeing, Carlos, you did a great job on those problems last time. This last test. I mean, you know, a little bit of confusion about two kinds of work, but it's always the same thing. And now you're starting to pick up on it. I can see we can start to see how we can really build on what we have. I would just suggest this, and I noticed this for you as well. When you look at the book, and they start to derive equations to get to a new place, like for example, if you look at page with me on page 98, just take a minute. And they're talking about a closed system here. Like a hydraulic cylinder of some sort. It's kind of a schematic of one. And if you read this over carefully, you get down to this line. It says, the work done on the fluid is the force times the distance. Yeah, we know that. But then they take a look at that fluid pressure is always force divided by area. So they rearrange the formulas. There's one, two, three, four, five lines, and at the fifth line, they finally come up with some with an equation, and then they put it in a box. Do you need to know how they got to that?
Nope.
If your curiosity in your mind challenges to say, how do we get from there to there? You can look at it. It's all algebra, and you can figure it out. But you know what? You don't need to put it on your on the sheet of paper that you use for a test. All you need is the final result, right? So you don't need to put all these intermediate equations. Carlos had quite a bit of intermediate information in some of his stuff on that sheet, and it turns out it gets you confused instead of helping you out.
We're not going to have a test, obviously, until Thursday, which is the midterm.
The midterm. We're scheduled, let's see.
It's next Thursday?
Well, I think that's the case. Let me just double check it, because that's what I was working on when you guys came in, but I'm having problems with my computer again. I think it is on the, yes, it is on the 4th.
Is there going to be like a,
on the 22nd. It's a is that a Thursday?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a week from today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
A week from today. So next Tuesday we'll finish.
Are we done learning stuff and is next Tuesday going to be like a midterm review or no?
I'm hearing you. I try to review every day some way, to review the whole thing again. We probably could do some of it that class. I don't know if all of it, because we have to get to, I'd like to get to a certain point on that. So I guess, yeah, we will do some review together. If that's what you want to do and you think that'll help, let's do some review
what's
together.
The midterm going to be up to?
Well, you know, based on we have, this is lesson 11, that will be lesson 13. So we have a couple more classes. We're going to do probably work in electrical systems. That'll get us through.
That would be on the midterm?
And that, yep, up through work on electrical systems. And then here's the, I guess, good news, in a way. There is no work analogy in thermal systems. It just doesn't seem to be, it doesn't follow logically. So we don't do a work section for thermal. So the first two chapters of the book.
Stop right before rate.
Yeah, stop just before rate.
So then for next week, we're going to have to do work in electrical systems plus the questions form by
that,
Tuesday, right?
That's,
we're not,
well, by Thursday. Then Thursday we can address the review and the answers to the questions, but we won't add a new read and take notes. You won't read ahead. You'll stop there.
Thursday's the midterm.
Right. I'm sorry. Today's Thursday, Tuesday, Thursday, Thursday. Okay, all right. Okay, well, let's see what we get done. That's my goal, was to get through that. Let's see, if there's too much to it, we'll cut it back some. We'll certainly get some of this work in electrical systems done.
Okay.
I hope to get some done today, because already I can see we're making some progress on these problems, and we did the lecture the last time, and I kind of covered some of that with Elijah, and you can see the tape from last time too, I think, if you really needed to. Oh, we didn't do the tape last time.
We did the tape. I mean, you can listen to it, but we didn't take the lens off the camera. So you can listen to it, but you just can't see it.
It's a task. Okay, so let's stay on task. Let me just check to see that the assignment's in, and what we can do is let's take a look and see what the answer is. Why don't we just kind of go quickly through those? I can look over your shoulder as we do.
One more question.
Oh, any number of questions. Go ahead. Tell me. Ask me your questions.
Our sheet, our cheat sheet.
We're gonna address that in whole. We're gonna end up with four different sheets, the way I finally decided to do. We're gonna end up with one for mechanical, one for fluid, one for electrical, and one for thermal. So that we won't have you know, jumbled. And again, as I said in last class, and you can look at any, look at the index to the book, and you can see the way it's divided. The first chapter was about prime movers, and we had equations for mechanical, fluid, electrical, and thermal. And the next one's going to be work. We have equations for mechanical, fluid, thermal, I'm sorry, electrical, and no thermal that time. So if you just have all the equations for all the mechanical, then all you have to do when you read a problem, if it's a jumble of problems, all kinds of problems, just ask yourself, is this a mechanical problem, a fluid problem, a thermal problem, or an electrical problem? Go to that sheet, you have all your equations.
So you're going to provide that?
And I'm in the process of making it up, but I'm having nightmares with this. Every time I come in here to do something, the thing crashes, and I don't get it. Something's goofy. I don't know what it is.
Oh, it's something with, like, the internet. Like, you can't, for some things, you can't hook up to the internet with, like,
yeah.
I can't hook up on my phone, but I can hook up on my computer.
I'm not sure. I have much more luck at home, and I'm going to have to spend more time at home doing it to get it ready. But it'll be ready. It'll be ready next time. And we've sort of kept up with it as we're going along. And as long as you're able to use it, but we'll have that sheet in hand for next time. So, let's see. I checked yours. I just need to see. Were you able to do any of the math stuff?
No.
You start writing down.
Pretty much from 10.
10 on. Okay. So what I look for, and again, these kinds of things.
Yeah.
Can you get them so they look like something over pounds per square inch, you know, instead of that, and revolutions over a minute, so you can see, you know, what you have to do to get conversions. If you write them this way, it's just a little hard to see what the conversion work has to be for it. So PSI and RPM, I'd rather say revolutions over minutes, and if it has to be revolutions in an hour, you can change it. But, you know, this is kind of confusing when you're doing this kind of work with units of measure. So when you're writing things down like this, you have to put a symbol to them. What's the 53.8 pounds?
Yeah, I didn't know. That's why I didn't.
Okay, well, but you should know from all the work we've done in the past what 53. What pounds measures? What does pound measure?
Force.
Right. So you put F, right?
Yeah.
Feet. What does that measure? You know, it's a distance or a radius or something. So trying to put symbols to these things is because the equations are all written in symbols, right? So if you have a list of the things in the problem with the symbols, then it's a matter of looking and say, okay, which ones have the same symbols, or which ones are the closest one I might have to use. It might give you some clues on how to get started. That'll be a little bit of a thing we could go on the extra help session, perhaps. All right. I checked these notes last time for you guys. I hadn't checked them for Elijah, so I just wanted to look at the problem.
So I got the first 7.
Good.
And then after that, it was no bueno.
That's getting some. Okay, again, same thing, where we try to make the list, we try to get the variables listed, and then we can see if how far you can go. So all I can ask, go as far as you can. I don't expect you to get them all right, but I would like to see if that skill level of putting a variable next to a number from reading the problem, that's going to be the thing that'll make you.
Number 2.
Yep.
When a fluid does positive work in a steady flow process, and the volume is constant, does the pressure of the fluid increase or decrease? The pressure decreases if everything continues. So, like, I don't know if that makes sense, but like, the way I was thinking, like.
You're right. You're right. It is. Let me ask you. Go ahead. You were going to say. I want to hear how you reasoned it out. Go ahead.
Well, like.
First of all, did you think of it as an open system or a closed system?
I thought of it as a open system because, like, if everything.
That's correct because pump is an open system. That's this system. So this is the model you're thinking about.
Yeah, because if every I was thinking of like a garden hose, like it pumps it out, but if the further the distance the water goes, the less pressure it has.
It decreases over time.
Like, yeah, if you put like a 1-inch hose onto a 2-inch hose or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah. That's
the pressure goes further and further and further away. Where like if you go from a 3-inch pipe to a 2-inch to a 1-inch, the pressure continually increases.
Yeah, it increases, You're in a different chapter section. You know, some of the things you said are correct. The best thing to do is to think in, think about this chapter in the simple terms of, if it's a pump, okay, and that's what this is. This is a pump situation, open system. Then what you're doing is you're adding, if the pump is moving the water up the hill, the pump is doing positive work, but when you calculate it, that positive times this positive gives you a negative work. And that makes sense because this is the fluid work. When the pump does work on the fluid is doing negative work. Right? Think about that. When does the fluid do positive work? The fluid does positive work when the fluid that's been pumped up and
is
moving down and doing some work. Right? It's falling down and turning a turbine, for example. So, you know, so pumps are open systems. The pump will always do positive work on the fluid because otherwise you don't need the pump. And so that means it's going to raise the fluid to some extent, overcome friction. It does some other stuff too. But for the most part, it's going to raise it. It's going to raise the pressure. The pressure coming out of a pump has to be greater than the pressure going in. Otherwise, you wouldn't need the pump. Just connect it directly. So again, the reason for that negative sign is just that when you calculate work, you think about it from the pump, this is going to be positive, but from the fluid perspective, if you're having work done on the fluid, as opposed to the fluid doing the work, that's called negative work.
Okay.
And then negative work is decreasing pressure?
Decreasing pressure.
So then for five?
That's the only way that can happen. You have to have a decrease in pressure. The only way you can have a decrease in pressure, see if this is a decrease, that's negative. Negative times negative gives you positive. And that's what would happen. So anytime the pressure is getting less, and the way only way you can get pressure to be less is to lower the fluid level. And that means it's coming off a high cliff, coming down. Does waterfall do work? Yeah, it does work. It breaks up rocks. It actually heats up the air down below. It adds more kinetic energy to the molecules. So it's doing work as it's losing its energy. It's turning into kinetic energy, motion of molecules.
How about for 5A, it says a sailboat moves forward in the wind.
Yeah, does the, now again, does it the air, the does air. The air do the do positive work?
Yeah.
Yep, because it's pushing. And it's moving something in the same direction that it's pushing. So again, that pressure and forward motion, right? So if you see that positive, where the motion is in the direction of the pressure, then you know you got positive work. Okay? Motion in direction of the pressure, but it's the pump that does the positive work. So again, you can, two different perspectives.
So if they ask them about the pump, then it would be positive.
That's right. So it's the opposite sign. Yep, the opposite sign. Any others in that set?
Those were like, and then it's
Let's just do something real simple. Turn back one page to 102. All right, you tell me, open or closed?
Where?
All right, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five different ones. Let's see if they're open or closed. That's the first thing. Because then, once you know open or closed, what does that tell you? It teaches you which equation to use, right? There's two different equations.
On 102.
So on 102, let's see. Other fluid systems that do work. Burning a fuel air mixture in a cylinder of an internal combustion engine.
Closed.
I agree with you, because a cylinder, combustion, right? That gas is trapped. When the work is done by the fluid and by the gases in there, it moves a piston, right?
Yeah.
So you can see that's a trapped system. That's not one that's just, you know, pumping something through so that it can go somewhere else. Heart pumping blood.
Open.
It's open. Even though you say, well, I use the same blood. Yeah, but, you know, it's the pump is here, and it's pumping it into a reservoir, if you will. It comes back through the veins. It's not a closed system. You're not moving a boundary. This is what closed systems are like. You know, the work being done on the fluid or by the fluid moves a boundary somewhere.
Well, your lung is a closed system.
Your lung?
Open.
But it goes out.
It goes out. So, again, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
But
that's more of a it's almost mechanical fluid combination, because you have to unwittingly you contract muscles to shrink the size of your lungs.
Right.
That compresses the air and it has to go out somewhere, right? Same thing when you build up gas in your stomach. I mean, you say, you know, it may feel like a closed system at times. You stay like this, but I mean, eventually, you know, you expend that gas. So
other than the review that we're going to do on Tuesday, mm-hmm. are you going to make like a kind of like a study guide for the intern?
I don't. I think that's what we're talking about when we have those two sheets of paper.
Yeah, but those are just equations.
They are, and so the rest of that is I think in the objectives, yeah. and in the summaries, and in the reading and in the class discussions that you to glean what the major concepts are and vocabulary in there. I mean, we could do it in a study guide our review. Our extra help session, if you want, we could do something like that.
Yeah, I mean, I just don't want to go over the weekend and just study this whole book and then only come up with half of the knowledge when half of it I don't even need to know.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what you don't need to know. I mean, if you're going to be intelligent about the four systems, and they exist on every ship that I know, I mean, so part of its vocabulary, the major concepts, like, you know, that, you know, pressure difference is the thing that is the prime mover in fluid systems. And how do you do that? Well, you can elevate tanks and you get more pressure that way. You can use pump.
This makes more sense because this chapter and the last chapter make more sense to me because it's like stuff I've actually seen.
It's not a perfect world scenario.
Yeah.
The fluid chapter is the hardest chapter. It was the hardest chapter because even though we work with fluids all the time and we live immersed in a fluid and we dived into pools, it's not something that we tend to see the principles behind it. So Pascal's principle in a closed system, you know, if it's a closed system like this, the pressure is the same everywhere throughout the system. It gets transferred. Water seeks its own level, you know, equilibrium stuff. I mean, concepts like that are things that are behind the scenes. You just tend not to focus on them as much in life as you do on mechanical systems. And if it's vocabulary and concept help you need, then again, I say that's what the chapter review stuff is about at the end of each chapter. It's what the questions and the review exercises you do for homework every day or every other day or whatever. Those are where those concepts are and in the reading. So, you know, I wouldn't feel like you're reading stuff you shouldn't know. The stuff you don't need to focus on is when they are deriving equations. So, you know, when you see a bunch of lines, you know, equations and things being, it's like, you know, just take the one out of the box and say, you know, what does this mean to me? Do I know what this is trying to tell me? And if you do, from what you read, you don't have to go through every single mathematical line to understand how they derived it. So I guess I'm trying to help you, Carlos. I'm not sure if I'm satisfying you or not, but we can do some more in extra help session though on the vocabulary if you want and reviewing major concepts, if that helps. But I think that's what the book is designed to do with the objectives and the review. Okay, any other questions from that? Let's take a look at those open or closed again. We were on the middle of that when we went sideways there.
Refrigerator
compressor uses a piston and a cylinder to increase the temperature and pressure of the working fluid.
Closed.
It's closed. Right? It's a piston and a cylinder.
Yeah.
So you see that's, you know, something has to move. It moves at the boundaries. It's closed. It's not just pumping stuff out. The stuff that the refrigerant that's in there can't leave. It has to be compressed because it's dangerous for the environment. So it has to stay contained. Burning fuel expanding through a nozzle, so you ignite the hydrogen and oxygen, and the thrust of that lifts the rocket off. What do you think? Open or closed? That's open. It's open. It's like a pump, right? It may not be a mechanical pump. It's a chemical pump. It's pumping gases by virtue of exploding them first. Pushing down on the input cell. Well, that's almost too easy, but.
It says
hydraulic cylinder, so you know that's going to be a closed system right there. All right. And then so we're back to the questions at the end. We're all set for five. You need answers for five, or you figure them out. The sailboat moves forward in the wind. The air does positive work.
Thank you.
You move air out of your lungs when you exhale.
Negative.
That's negative because work is being done on the fluid, right? And a fan draws air through the car's radiator.
The fan's doing work on the air.
The fan's doing the work. It's drawing the air in, right?
Negative.
So the work is being done on the air by the fan.
Yeah, because they're talking about the air.
It's the air. So not, yeah, the not the fan does positive work.
If the air's doing the, if the air's making something move or doing that.
You see what, you see the difference?
It's positive.
If you're thinking about the fan.
If the air move, then
yeah,
it's negative.
That's right. If you're thinking about the fan, yeah, the fan's doing positive work. You know those little things the kids hold sometimes, what do they call them? They wave them. They like, look like a little fan, and they wait till the wind blows, and it blows the thing around. Okay, if I hold one of
them. That's
positive work.
That's what I think I was thinking
about. Right?
Like when you drive a car.
The air is doing positive work to remove the heat from the radiator. But by and large, you know, when the car stops, it's the fan that's causing that to draw. And the fan helps anyway. It helps direct it better. But so there's a little bit of both if you're moving fast enough. You don't need the radiator.
And then D is negative? Positive.
Balloon flies
around. You know, you put the balloon fly around.
You open it up and the air
is pushing.
The balloon's pushing the air out. But the air is pushing the balloon forward. So the question is, what do you want to talk about, the balloon or the air? See, the balloon pushes the air out, right?
Right.
They're asking you to...
It flies around the room. So the balloon's pushing it out.
Tell what the air does. If the balloon is pushing on the air, that's negative work for the air. But here the air, the action reaction, the air is actually pushing the balloon forward, isn't it?
So that'd be positive.
So it is positive.
It's what is making the balloon fly.
That's right. It's what's making the balloon fly.
The air.
It is the air. Exhausting the air out is what makes the balloon fly. Just like when we have a rocket, same thing. It's the thrust of that causes the thing to go up in the air. Okay, six, we all set with six? A is true or false, Carlos?
True. I got false.
Yeah, I think, let's take a look at it. In a closed system, that's this system here, right, Carlos? If the fluid is doing work and pushing a load, that's positive work. Is it possible to reverse that and get negative work? Do work on the fluid. Push the piston, make the thing compress. Like go out to the screen door out here. Open the screen door. And then when you let it go, there's a spring. The spring is pulling the door back in, and it's compressing the air. You can hear the air hissing its way out of the system. So the answer to the question, don't be confused about this. There's positive work and negative work in every system, depending on what's happening to what, right? So the answer is it's false. You can't just have one kind of work. If you have positive work in a system, the negative work can appear in that system as well. Is the thing doing the work, or is something is the work being done on it? If it's being done on it, it's negative. B. Pressure and volume are both constant. The fluid does no work.
False.
Oh, really? If the force and the distance are both constant,
there's no work,
right? So isn't that the same kind of thing? In other words, it's saying the volume is constant. Is the thing moving, is the piston moving if the volume is constant? Is it moving up or down? Not moving either way. If the volume is constant and the pressure is constant, everything's in equilibrium, nothing's moving, right?
So it's true.
The fluid does no work. If fluid work is negative, then the work is done on the fluid. What do you say to that?
Sure.
Yeah, that's what we've been saying over and over again. That's how you know when to say negative and when to say positive. In a steady flow system, that's the pump, the final pressure is always greater than the initial pressure.
I think it's false, but I said sure because it's like a waterfall.
Well, it is, but what about the other way? How did the water get up there? It got there from a pump.
Well,
so pumping up, right, and then it coming down. So there's two sides to every system.
I was thinking of like a waterfall.
Well, then you were thinking about it correctly, but I was thinking about the pump. So the question is always. See that word always? When you see always, always think twice when you see always, because there's you have to think about exceptions to the rule as well.
So what is it?
Well, it's false. Steady flow process. You pump some water up to a reservoir, and now the reservoir spills the water over to come back down to turn a turbine. Right? I mean, you think about that as an example. So there's negative work and positive work in that system, isn't there?
But if I was thinking of it as a waterfall, I said it was true because of gravity. Like, initially it starts up high, and gravity takes it down. So the final...
Well, if it's higher, what's the pressure, higher or lower? The higher water is...
Lower.
But more or less pressure if it's higher. The higher water, the deeper, the higher, the... Water tanks in the air.
More pressure.
That's what this equation is. And that's one of the basic principles we learn. And that's why they take, I mean, wouldn't it be easy just to leave the reservoir water in the reservoir? Why do they take it and pump it for miles to get it up into a tank so everybody can get pressure? The higher you hold it, the more pressure you have. We talked about taking a sun shower, one of those bags. You hold it up in the air, you're gonna get more pressure in your shower.
Right.
You know, so same kind of idea. Anytime you elevate water, it has higher pressure. So the pressure of the water is higher at the top of that waterfall than it is the water pressure is actually getting less. Now, the speed of it's getting higher, and it can do damage when it hits things at the bottom. That's the work it does. But from the pressure point of view, water is always considered to be higher pressure when it's pumped to a higher level. Higher pressure, that's a very key equation. We've been using it, you know, a couple of times now, and you can't forget this one. This is critical.
Deep.
That's height or depth.
So when it's real deep, the water pressure is more?
Yeah, because if you go down and you look up, the water above you is higher. The higher the water is over your head, the more pressure you're going to feel. You go down 2 miles, it'll crush you because...
Water reservoirs underwater.
Well, you know, they use, that's called head pressure, and they use that to help pumps. I have a pump in my well.
Right.
Now, my neighbor has pump, he has it in the cellar. One hose goes down into the well, he pumps the water out of the well and then into the house. Well, I have an old-style pump, and it's been there for 40 years, and it still works as well as it did day one. I know guys who have had pumps in the ground over 60 years. It's still working. They take the pump, they drop the pump down into the well. That makes the work the pump has to do easier. How come?
Because it doesn't have to produce as much pressure.
Because the water pressure sitting in the well is pushing the water back up to level. And you can see that, you know, there's actually an advantage to that. All right.
So pressure, right, all that derives around sea level, right? The height is either above sea level or below sea level.
Well, right? You can use any reference you want.
Would make the pressure higher, above or below?
Yeah, you could say that, yep. So there's no absolute reference point.
But equal pressure is supposed to be where we are right now. Not equal because it's still pressure in the air, but...
Well, yeah, there's air pressure. And then the other thing is, it doesn't matter whether you have this water tower in Boston at sea level or up in Denver at a mile high. It doesn't matter. It's the difference from where you started to where you ended. So if that difference is the same, then the water pressure change is the same.
Doesn't matter if you're up on a mountain... And going down 10 feet.
Say I had
even if you're right here going down 10
say
feet.
I had held my sun shower this high every time. Okay? The difference in height is from the lowest to the highest. And whether I'm lower in sea level or up on top of a mountain, I still have that same thing.
Yeah, because it's the same distance.
Yeah. Yeah, the only thing that can really affect that is you start going way into space, then it's because the weight of things starts to diminish, and then that would change a little bit, because it's the weight density of the liquid that matters. And if you went way up and say you went to, you know, halfway to the moon, then that bag of water wouldn't have as much pressure, because it wouldn't weigh, the water wouldn't weigh as much. It wouldn't have the same weight density. All right, so that was six. The rest of calculation stuff.
What was seven, too?
Seven.
When a pump is not running, what is the water pressure at the output pipe of the pump?
Yeah.
Well, is that pump a valve, or is it open? I said that.
Well, it almost doesn't matter. It just, you know, whatever's connected to the pump. If you have a tower and the water is 105 feet above that pump, and again, it doesn't matter whether it's sea level or wherever it is, it's 105 feet difference between where the pump is and the water is. That water is going to come down and it's going to enter that pump with some pressure, isn't it?
Yeah, so I said.
So you just use weight density times height.
So if the pump is not running, it should be at a constant pressure.
That's right.
With the flow, unless the valve is closed. Because if it's closed, it's going to build up pressure.
Well, the pressure will stay where it is. It's not going to change the pressure by closing a valve. It just prevents the flow. I mean, what is the pressure of any liquid depend on? It depends on the weight density of it and the height. The height here is 105 feet, right?
Yeah.
So if I look and see what's connected to the pump, right at that connection, where that tower water is directed through a hose and finally comes down, right there, there's 105 feet worth of pressure, whatever that's going to come out to be. We have to look up the weight density of water, which is 62.4 pounds per cubic.
But like, if the valve's closed and that pressure builds up, right?
Well, I don't know what would build it up.
Well, you have all if that you water, and then when you open it up, it's going to rush out and eventually it'll steady back out. But that.
Well, eventually it'll be zero when the water level is down to the pump.
It'll stay the same pressure until all the water's
gone. As soon as the water pressure starts to drop, as soon as the water level starts to drop, the pressure is going to be a little bit less.
Right. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Is that what you're saying?
Like, once that valve's open.
Yes. The water level starts to diminish. As this gets less and less and less, the pressure gets less and less and less and less and less, until finally the height is zero. It's back right down to that same level. Then there's no pressure anymore. Okay, for whatever that's worth. So if I want to know what the pressure is at that pump, all I need to know is how high is the water above that pump. And if it's 105 feet, and on your list of constants, there's a number we've used quite a few times, that the weight density of water, 62.4. Is it 0.4 or 0.5? I forget.
0.4.
And that's in pounds per cubic foot. And that's important, you know, to have. So we cancel the feet and we end up with a pressure. And this is the equation for fluid pressure. If you look at your sheet, that should be on there from the chapter we did back in the beginning. The fluid pressure is weight density times height. Feet and feet cubed. I'll get rid of feet. I'll get rid of I'll get rid of one out of three here. So what I'll end up with is feet squared. And I know that pounds over square feet is a pressure. Pressure is always a force, that's pounds, divided by an area, and area is square units of length. So that's pounds per. So that matches up units wise. Number wise, you can figure that out to be somewhere around 6,000 and change, right? Okay, how are we doing here? So if you know that number and then you get five additional PSI to overcome friction, the only thing you have to do is worry about converting pounds per square inch. Now, you could add it directly, but if you got pounds per square foot, and then you have an additional 5 pounds per square inch, don't you have to get those to the common units of measure? Do we need to see that one more time, how to do the conversion? Yeah, okay. Don't be bashful to say yes. You know, that's what you need to do. That's what we need to do. So let's take that additional. So the fluid pressure at the pump comes out to be, and what was the final answer here? I'll write it if you have it.
Okay, which question is it?
2.4 times.
Times 105.
It's 6,552.
6,552. What number are we on, just to make? Seven, thank you.
I mean, we're on eight.
Yeah, 6552. Everybody see that? 6552, and that's in pounds per, I write it with a divide, square foot, and that is a pressure. I know that's a pressure. That's the fluid pressure at the pump. But we now have to add five more PSI. So we go to add PSI. We can't add PSI because PSI is pounds per square inch. And those, you can't add apples and oranges, right? You got to have them the same. So let's take the 5 pounds per square inch and get it into pounds per square foot, right? So let's do that. So how do I start? When I know, once I can frame the problem, I see what the problem, what am I looking for? What do I have now? How do I convert it? That's the whole idea. That's the thinking process. Every time you got to do a conversion. So you start with the desired units. What are the desired units? Not just feet.
Pounds
per square feet is what we're looking for, right? We don't know how many it's going to be.
Cause how much pressure? No, we're looking for, no, we want to convert that into inches.
But why does it say it?
Because at the end it says in PSI.
Oh, it does say in PSI, so I apologize.
So
we could get them both into pounds per square foot, or we could get them both into pounds per square inch. That's where reading the question helps you frame that, right? So let's do that then. So far we know we have to add 5 PSI. That's 5 pounds per square inch. But we have 6552, it has to be converted, so let's get that converted. I times and fraction line, right? It's gonna convert this. I wanna get it into what? Pounds per square inch. I know the answer in pounds per square foot. What do I do?
Put pound on the bottom.
Put, well, pounds is already, pounds is good. Do I want to convert pounds?
I mean, you want to put,
See, pounds appears here and here, so I don't want to change that.
Inches.
Feet squared's in the wrong place.
You want to put feet squared.
Feet squared on top. Get rid of the one you don't want to keep. What would you like to have on the bottom? It says it right over there. Inches squared. Can we go inches to feet squared? We should be able to, but here's the caveat.
Cancel out the exponents, don't you?
No, you do not cancel out the exponents. Oh my God, no. You can't, because that's part of the answer. They have to be there. The only thing I've done here effectively is cancel units, but I haven't done anything else. What people want to do is they want to put 1 foot and 12 inches and walk away, and they're going to get it wrong every time, aren't they? What do you need to remember to do? Because this said feet squared and I knew 1 foot, and this said 12 inches, this said inches squared and I knew 12 inches, I knew feet and inches, how do I get the square business? You take the conversion factor that goes with one dimension, 1 foot, 12 inches, and you square it. You square them, remember that? So you have to remember that. When you go to convert a square unit, you got to square the conversion factor. The conversion factor is 12 inches to a foot, but it's 12 squared to a foot squared. This turns out to be 144. If I look at a piece of graph paper, and that's a square inch, if I have a foot by a foot, I'm not just going to have 12 of them. How many square inches do you use? I see a bunch of square inches. It would be 12 by 12, right? 144, 12 squared. So that's how you get to that answer. And so 6552 divided by 144, that's what this comes out to be. That will tell me my answer in pounds per square inch. Anybody got the answer off the top of their head? Otherwise, I can do it.
45.
Thank you. Very nice. 45 and a half or 45, let's say 45. They said 45 and a half. I don't care. Pounds per square inch. Well, that's the fluid pressure, but there's the additional pressure. Now, can I add pounds per square inch and pounds per square inch? Yeah, you can add apples and apples. So 45 and a half plus 5 gives me 50 and a half, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So there's my answer, 50.5. So converting is key. Making that list is key. Making sure you try to connect the dots as best you can. And we're getting better at it, and I'm real pleased to see that we are getting better at it. And you know, it'll get even easier if you keep doing the same thing.
I hate these questions about Like there's three questions on one.
Yeah.
If you get the first one wrong, you get all of them
wrong. It bumps through, yeah. Not that I would never do that. You know, if I saw you did the right thing with the wrong answer to start and get the right next, I'm going to give you credit for those, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
If we did the right.
Yeah, yeah. Formulas, the right list, and you just use the wrong answer from another part. I'm not going to take the points off on that. That's not fair. Anything else?
The nine goes with the same thing.
Yep. How much work does the pump do? Well, you know, now that you know the pounds per square inch pressure, you know that the pressure has to be 50.5, right? So for that next question, you know that now the total pressure that has to be exerted is 45.5 plus 5, 50.5, and that's in pounds per square inch. Okay, that's your pressure total. How much volume are we looking at? 120 cubic feet. Now we get this issue here again. And we're looking for the amount of work?
Yeah.
Read the question.
How much work does the pump do?
Okay, this is the pump work now, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you know, it's going to push the fluid forward. So we know the work's going to be positive. The pump's going to do positive work, right? Because it's going to increase the pressure and it's going to move the fluid. So, you know, the sign thing doesn't really matter so much. We know that it's pressure change times. Here we have a problem, don't we?
Our equation says it's negative.
It does, but that's the fluid pressure, right? So you can put that in there. But if the pump is moving the fluid, right, that's work being done on the fluid. You follow me? So the fluid pressure would be negative. If you put the pressure difference in as a negative, right? Then you end up with a positive. So, I mean, you can do it two ways. You can pay attention to the sign or you can reason it out. But in any case, they want the amount of that work done. And the amount of work will be the pressure times the volume. But here's the problem. We get the volume and the pressure, and now they're back in inconsistent units again, aren't they? So again, we're forced to do another conversion. So does it say specifically? Well, we do work in Newton meters typically, or in foot pounds typically, right? Those are the English system, foot pounds. So I would keep the feet this time. Let's see what they did in their solution. Yeah, they kept the feet also.
Okay.
So let's keep this in feet. So let's make that change. Well, we already, you know, we could have done it the other way from the beginning. I mean, it depends on what they're asking us to do, but we'll do whatever they want us to do. They want us to practice converting is what they want us to do. How do I get pounds per square inch into pounds per square foot would be the question, right? So that's just the opposite kind of calculation we did down here. So we'll take it again. Now that I know the answer is 50.5. Let's convert it. What do I want to have it in? I want to have it in pounds per... No, I'm sorry. I want this in foot pounds. That's the work, right? I want the work done in foot pounds. So that feet's okay. It's this one I got to change. So how do I set up the conversion factor here? If you're not sure, you could write down what you're looking for. You're looking for pounds per square foot. You're starting with pounds per square inch. You need to get it in pounds per square foot. That's the conversion. What do I do here? What are the numbers?
You put feet up the top, inches up the top.
Inches on the top, because see inches on the bottom? Got to get rid of that first, and then I'm going to put a square. And then what do I need down here? I need feet squared. Check to see if that works. Inches squared cancel. I got pounds left on the top and feet squared on the bottom, and that's what this shows. So I know I'm going to get it right if I can just remember to square the factors.
140.
1 foot goes in here. You square it, you get one. This is 12 squared or 144. So it's this times this to get to the answer in pounds per square foot. What does that come out to be?
7,272.
Let's call it 2720. 7270, is that right?
Yeah.
27. And that's in pounds per foot square. That's what we got, pounds per foot square. Well, this is the pressure. There's my delta P. There's the pressure drop, pressure change that's going to occur. There's the volume. It's in cubic feet. Now I got it. So what's work equal to?
You times them, right?
You times them. And again, you write the equation. What's the equation? Work equals the negative of delta P times volume, right? This is fluid pressure. They asking us for fluid pressure or pump? I'm sorry, fluid work, rather. Are they asking us for fluid work or the work done by the pump?
Work done by pump.
By pump. What do? I drop the negative sign. Do you follow me?
So you did it wrong in the book?
No, no.
The answer comes out negative in the answers in the
book. Uh-huh.
That's why I checked it.
Came on, negative. How much work must the pump do to put? And they got it as negative, they got it wrong.
I think so. Don't they?
No, I don't see negative on this.
Oh, never mind.
No, they had it in the equation. No, they dropped it just like I said to drop it. They just come up. It can't be negative because the pump is raising water up in the air. It's got to be positive.
Oh, I looked at the example of the pump.
Okay. So the change in pressure. I'm sorry, the delta P is 7,270, or 7.2, 7 times 10 to the third, and the volume is 120 cubic feet. Multiply those, you get the work done, and what is this going to come out to be? It's going to come out to be...
Well, you have to put in the...
Put in the units, and you can check it out. That's right. Check it out.
They cancel out.
Right. Pressure is in pounds per square foot. And 120 is cubic feet. What's it gonna be?
It's gonna be pounds per foot.
No, it's not. Do that very carefully.
Foot-pounds.
It's gonna be foot pounds, and that's what it should be. It better come out in a unit of work,
right,
which is foot pounds.
The feet on the bottom get canceled.
Yeah, this all gets canceled. Only two out of three up here get canceled. Now I'm left with pounds on the top and feet on the top, and that's foot-pounds, isn't it? And that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for consistency. Foot-pounds is what I should have because that's what they asked me to get. That's what I did all the converting for, and that's what it works out to be. So converting continues to be an issue. Making the list, I think we're getting better at that. I hope we are. This chapter is all about two things. Is it open or closed? So I use this equation or the other one. And then just go ahead and put the numbers, but pay attention to converting. Little things to figure out. They tell you a diameter of a piston instead of an area. You know, you might have to do those kinds of things consistently. We've been through those over and over again. We'll keep on doing them until they get to be second nature. Start asking yourself the question. Now, do I know what this is? What's the area, volume? Okay, that's all the way through 9. And 10 we did on the board to begin. We did 11. Did you guys try 12?
Yeah. He's a bathroom.
That's, you're lifting a truck.
It's a hydraulic
with
cylinder.
Yeah.
Closed.
Right. So first of all, if you know, is this all fluid work or is there?
No, it's a work problem.
It's a work. It's a regular mechanical work problem, isn't it? Force times distance gives you work.
Yeah.
That's the work. Input or output?
Input.
Read the problem. What's doing what to whom? Is there a hydraulic cylinder in here?
It said, yeah, the arm is used to lift a 53.
It lifts the door.
Door, 4.2 feet, and hold it in place while the hinge bolts are installed.
Okay. So what's the input work? See, and Carlos, this is where that efficiency and machine idea comes in. You know, work is not always just force times distance. It could be torque times theta. Now we got another one, don't we?
Yeah.
We have three kinds of work to look for now. We got the mechanical work. Remember that work? That's the definition. Force parallel times distance. And you're pretty good with that, right? That's on your equation sheet already. That's straight line motion, remember that? That's translational, we call it, right? What other kind of work did we learn about in mechanical systems?
Torque.
So it can go around in circles, and that's torque times theta, and that's where the radian stuff came in, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so that was the chapter on mechanical work. Now we're in fluid work. What do we know? There's another way that hydraulic cylinders can do work, and pumps can do work, right?
So that's the volume.
And that's the volume pressure thing. So depending on whether it's open or closed, you have two more equations, don't you? The work, and these are all both fluid work. Work fluid. One is open, one is closed. Let's look at the open system. And then we'll look at the closed system. There's two different ones. What's the difference? Well, they're both basically pressure times volume, aren't they? But let's take an open system. What's the constant?
The pressure.
No. In the open system, it's a pump system.
Oh.
The volume is the thing that pumps steady. The volume in an open system is what's steady. So this case, in an open system, it's the change in pressure that's created by the pump. Think of it that way. When you see the change here, you know there has to be a pump because the change in pressure is from a pump. This is the pump system, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And then again, what do we know? We know that when there's a change in pressure times volume, that the equation for the work done has a negative in front of it, doesn't it? So that's one equation. We end up with negative delta P times V. You can do it this way. It's fine. It doesn't matter. The negative's out there somewhere. In a closed system, what's the deal? In a closed system hydraulic cylinder, there's a pump somewhere that's pumping fluid into the system at a steady rate. So it's in the closed system, the cylinder system, where the pressure is the thing that doesn't change. And what happens to the volume of that fluid as the piston moves back and forth? What happens to the it changes. So we have P times change in V. So here we have a constant pressure with a changing volume. Here we have a constant volume with a changing pressure. So this is the pump. The open system is the pump. And the closed system is the hydraulic cylinder. I'll just put HC for hydraulic cylinder, or HY, hydraulic cylinder. Okay? So in this problem, we're looking at work again. But something's doing work in order to do work on something else, right? Mm-hmm. What kind of work do we have when we have a hydraulic cylinder lifting a load? Well, the lifting of the load is just a regular old, you lift and it goes, right? That's the regular old work. Mm-hmm. On the test, even I'm not giving it away for him, on the test we had something going around in a circle doing rotational work in order to cause something to happen. Now we're going to find that we could have cylinders or pumps working input in order to get something else to happen. And if I look at this problem and I try to understand the whole problem before I start doing anything, I'm seeing that a hydraulic cylinder is being used, and it has its own calculation. The hydraulic cylinder is this business here. This is the equation for work. The hydraulic cylinder is doing work in order to lift a load. So there's an input and an output again, isn't there? And therefore there'll be input work, output work, and we could calculate percent efficiency if we wanted to, couldn't we? Because machines, again, input work, output work. The output is always the load. You get a rotating motor, lifts a load. We went in that lab, we did that. We rotated the thing, it lifted a load. We did rotational work, and we lifted a load, straight line. So we related this in the equation in the lab to that one. These were the two. We did this, that's what came out of it. Mm-hmm. Today in the lab, we're going to pump fluid. We're going to have electricity, and that's one we haven't studied yet, but we're going to be into it by the time we have to finish the lab. We use electrical work to cause the pump to do fluid work in order to raise water a certain height. So there are, you can see there's a transition going from one kind of work to another, and that's the way systems are. They're complex. Nothing's ever straight one thing or another. It's a combination of things. But you can break it down and look at it many different ways. So the new tool we have is to be able to calculate fluid work so we can relate it to whatever happens here. If I had a waterfall turning a turbine, I would have fluid work, open system, right? Fluid work doing rotational work, because turning a turbine means you've got to turn it around in a circle. So I could relate those two. Find out which one's input, which one's output. And I could put those in the equations for efficiency and machines again. So you can see the connection between them. So look at 12 then. Right away, my temptation is, I see I'm going to end up with lifting a truck door. Mm-hmm. I'm tempted to just calculate the mechanical work. And I know that's output. Do you know that's output? If you can see that, so why not? You stick that on the side over there and you say, okay, I know how much the door weighs, 53.8 pounds. Let's check your number 12, see if you have it. If you don't, you can start taking some notes. That's the force. How far are we lifting this door?
4.2 feet.
That's all mechanical work needs, just those two things. I multiply those, and I get my answer in foot-pounds, don't I? So I end up with like 4 times 50 is 200, so I'm going to say it's about 230. What do you say?
225.9.
Okay, I guess 230, that's not bad, 225. So let's say. Two, 25.9, you said?
9.6, yeah.
Oh, I'm going to 226, good enough for me. Good enough? 226? Mm-hmm. And that's foot-pounds. Mm-hmm. And that's the work on the load, right? Yeah. That's the work done on the load. So I know that that's going to be, let's see, a positive work, right? Yep, okay. And I know it's in foot-pounds, and that's the output then, isn't it? Since it's the load, that's our work output. You connect the words output and load together, right? When we do that kind of, so this is the output work. Okay, now we can look at the input work. What's causing this thing to move? A hydraulic cylinder is. Well, as soon as I see hydraulic cylinder, I think what? Open or closed system? Closed system. As soon as I think closed system, I look on my sheet and I find the equation for closed system. The equation for closed system is the one right down there. It's P times change in V, right? Work, the fluid work is equal to pressure times change in volume. That's the closed system equation. That's never going to change. So once you know it's a closed system, you know there's fluid involved, that's where you go. So I'm looking for a pressure, if I'm looking for a steady pressure, you see anything there? Oh, they're going to ask us for that, aren't they? Oh, okay, well, so we make the list. That's the question mark. I don't know what the pressure is going to be. Do I know how much work?
Yeah.
I know how much work if, in fact, I have a 100% efficient machine. Right?
Yeah, so they want you to...
They want you to assume, when they don't tell you anything, you assume it's 100% efficient, don't you?
So the work would be the...
So the work would be the same work that's coming out. Right?
Yeah.
You just calculate the work coming out. So I'm going to say that the work number is 226 foot-pounds. That's ideal. That's 100% efficient. And I you know, I know there's no such thing, so we have to be careful. But that, when they don't tell us anything, that's the best we can do is come. If this was perfect, this is what would have to happen. I don't know the pressure. You know how much volume we're moving through this thing?
28 inches cubed.
A volume of 28 cubic inches of fluid. 28 cubic inches of fluid. I love the uh-oh because that tells me you're paying attention to units. Can you see the problem? Feet, inches. So right away we're going to do a conversion. So I'm going to do, and I can do this right in here. But you notice I chose the equation based on what I, closed cylinder bit business. I wrote that down. I'm putting in, I could make a list here. I could do it this way. There's a couple of ways to do it. You end up with the same result. Let's convert this. I don't want cubic inches. What do I want instead of cubic inches?
Feet.
I want cubic feet. So what do I do to get cubic inches out of there?
You want cubic feet?
If we have foot pounds here, and we want this in pressure in pounds per square inch, pounds per square foot, then I think we go with feet. Does it tell us what unit of pressure we want? Does it ask us? So it gives us a choice.
Yeah.
So we get to choose what pressure we're going to use for B. Want to use pounds per square inch? Or you want to use pounds? Just pounds per square inch. Okay, let's just do it in pounds per square inch. That's what they ended up doing.
Yeah, because then it's easier to convert the feet.
It is.
With the exponents.
Okay. So what am I converting here? Let's rearrange. We have to decide. Are we either going to convert the inches to feet or the feet to inches?
Feet to inches.
And that's what I think we just decided to do. So let's take 226 foot-pounds. We want inch.
Bottom inches on the top.
Pounds. So you put feet on the bottom.
Inch.
And inches on the top. And there's no squares here, right? Foot pounds and inch. So it's just a 12 inches, 1 foot. 226 divided by 12 is roughly 12.1 or 12.2. You times it by 12. 226 times 12 divided by 1. 2712, which isn't unlike what we said before. 2712, and now that's not in foot pounds anymore, that's now in
pounds.
Inch pounds. We got rid of feet. We change it to inches. We have work in inch pounds.
In the inches, these inches.
So now we can go ahead and do the calculation. In place of the 226, we now have converted that to 2712. So let me get rid of that conversion. Get rid of this. This converts to 2712 inch pounds. Well, we still don't know how much pressure that's going to be. That's the pressure. But we do know there's 28 cubic inches. Are these consistent? Yeah, they're consistent with one another. How do I get P when I know this and this? You divide both sides by, this says P times 28 on this side.
Divide by
28 on both sides.
Yeah.
Cubic inches. That goes away from this side. That leaves pressure alone.
6.9.
And this is divide by 28 cubic inches also. And then you get the number, and then what happens to the units, you'll see in a minute. Inch cancels once here, and once here. What am I left with when I cancel?
Inches
squared. So I'm at inches squared. And this is pounds on top and square inches on the bottom. Does pounds per square inch sound like the pressure we're looking for? It does, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. PSI, pounds per square inch. And what do you get? That's roughly 100, isn't it? Yeah, roughly 100.
96.9.
96 point something. 9, you said?
Yeah.
96.9 on 97. So work input and work output, you know, they're connected to each other. Lots of different ways work can be done. It can be done mechanically, translation, rotation, fluid, and we're going to learn also electrical can be done electrically. And that's the new lesson is on electrical work. So a lot of converting stuff, trying to be careful, trying to set it up. Part of it is having a system and making the and spread it out and take up a whole side of a sheet of paper if you have to, so it's clear to me and clear to you what you're converting. I'm doing this on a board and I'm erasing stuff and I'm going back and forth. Hopefully you have a logical sequence on your paper that you can follow, stuff like the lists that you make, the equations you write, where you put the numbers, include the units, check the conversions. That's the stuff that's driving some of us a little bit crazy. And it just isn't gonna go away because that's the nature of the beast. You know, they sunk a ship not too long ago. I think it was down in off of the coast of New Zealand. And I wish I could remember all the details. But it came down to somebody used a metric measurement instead of an English measurement. Somebody told them what to set the level to or gauge level to, and it ended up they didn't catch the thing in time. It ended up flooding some compartments, and the freaking ship sunk because somebody didn't convert meters to feet or something. I mean, little things like that just drive you crazy. So if you're gonna work on ships, especially ships that go all around the world, you had a little experience with that. I mean, there's all kinds of, there's metric gauges and English gauges, and people are talking, it's like they're talking two different languages half the time. When you have a handle on that whole picture, you know something about metric and English, and you know that it takes conversion work to do. You know, somewhere, I'm sure in many places on ships, there's places that have lists of conversion factors.
Things. Our ship was Chinese, so nothing was...
Not even in English.
Yeah, no, nothing was allowed. When we had to go to Florida for work, and they flew people from Germany to work on it.
They didn't want you making those simple mistakes. Yeah, yeah. You know, it's training. It's all about training. Okay. So I think we got that down. It's a good problem to look at. It's not. Not as complicated as it looks at first. You think about work in and work out always. If you're going to go through a machine, it does some work, work in, work out, and that'll help you get through that. 13, 14, and 15. There's nobody left. All right. What I could do with those, is I could just copy that, and you guys can try the 13, 14, 15 again if you want. Give you some hints on it when they get back. Okay, so 13, 14, 15, did you take a look at those? Do you want to take another try at those on your own? I'll make an answer sheet for those, or you want to go over them?
I mean, there's only 10 minutes left.
I know. So how about if I just give you a couple of hints, and then you can go ahead and try them? Mm-hmm. Have you read 13 over carefully? Yeah, this is the volume change, right? It's a contained, that's contained, isn't it? You blow at a steady pressure and the balloon changes size. What's the key? The last thing in the paragraph is in the parentheses. You see the parentheses?
Volume of the sphere.
It gives you the formula for the volume of a sphere, assuming the balloon is the sphere. So, yeah. And it's a function of radius, isn't it? 4/3 pi r cubed.
Well, they tell you the
diameter. They tell you the diameter at the beginning, and they tell you the diameter at the end, don't they? Okay. So we'll I'm just going to give you some hints on 13, 14, 15, so we can get on to the lab and maybe just a little bit more to work with. So you go back and try 13, 14, 15. I'll give you the answer sheets so you can see how you're doing. But let's just look at 13 together. You're blowing up a balloon. As you blow up the balloon, the volume changes, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. So there's a change in volume times pressure gives you work. That's what we would say, right? Pressure equals. And you've got to pick one. Either it's a steady pressure or, I'm sorry, it's either a steady volume or a steady pressure. This one has a steady pressure, and it's the volume that's changing, and that's going to equal the work done, isn't it? Okay? Pressure times change in volume. The pressure is given to you in the problem, so you can list that. They want you to calculate the work, so you need to find the change in volume. The only thing hard about this is that, you know, you have, and again, change in anything, V final and V initial, you're going to get those because they gave you the diameter of the balloon. But you can't put the diameter in, you got to put the volume in. What's the volume of a sphere? They give it to you, 4/3 pi r cubed. So that'll be the final radius. This will be 4/3 pi r cubed initial. Well, they tell you this is, the diameter is, what, 3 to, what's the beginning diameter? 3 centimeters diameter. So what's the radius you're going to stick in here? If it's a 3 centimeter diameter radius, I'm sorry, diameter, what's the radius? Half? Isn't the radius half of a diameter?
Yeah.
So you're going to put 1.5 in here, aren't you?
Yeah.
And that's going to be in centimeters, isn't it? But what are you going to do with the 1.5 according to that equation? You got to cube it. And you're going to cube the number, and you're going to come out with the units of measure cubed. This is going to be in cubic centimeters, isn't it? Because that has no units. Pi has no units. So we're going to come out in cubic centimeters here for the initial volume.
And the other one, too.
The other one ends up at 30 centimeters, I think. Is that what they said? 30. So what's the actual radius of that?
90.
No. If the diameter is 30, what's the radius? 15 centimeters, and then you got to cube that, don't you? But you'll have the two volumes, so you can find the change in volume. That'll come out in cubic centimeters, and then you multiply that by the pressure to tell the work, yes? Okay, are the units correct there? Let's see. We have pressure and kPa. Oh, boy. How's kPa work out here? Well, Pascal is newtons per square meter, right?
Same as a joule?
No, it's not the same as a joule. That's mixing work with pressure. And again, these are the things that drive you crazy. The pressure is 1 pascal is equal to 1 newton per square meter. That's what a pascal was. That's on your sheet somewhere. So thousands, kilopascals, are thousands of newtons per square meter. So knowing pascals has newtons and square meters, we have to make sure we're on the right page here.
Isn't that 14.7 psi?
14.7 psi is the atmospheric pressure. See, it says atmosphere?
Yeah.
That's atmospheric pressure. The 1.2 is above and beyond atmospheric pressure. So we're talking about just the amount that the balloon feels.
But atmospheric pressure is 101.3
kPa. 101.3, and this is 1.2 kilopascals over atmospheric pressure.
So
1.2.
102.5 kPa.
I don't know I'm not sure what you're driving at. What are we going to put in for pressure? If we have the volume here, this is in square meters. Notice the difference? You see the problem? If that's pascals, that's thousands of pascals, which is what kilopascals are. It has to relate to newtons and square meters. You see the problem? you see a square meters down here, you got cubic centimeter stuff. You've got to make a conversion here in order to work this out. What is this going to be if you're going to stick with, you're going to end up with newtons of force? You better make sure that that's in meters, not in centimeters. So you got to make a conversion again. So you got two volumes to calculate, and when you get done, you subtract the two of them, you end up with cubic centimeters. Convert that cubic centimeters so that you end up with cubic meters. If you do that, then you'll be all set. And that's cubic centimeters to cubic meters. Okay. What do you know about metrics? Which is bigger, meters or centimeters?
Meters.
And how many centimeters are there? 100, which I'm going to write as 10 to the second, if you don't mind. Now, what do I do about the cube? I have to cube the 1. What do I get? I get 1. What do I get down here when I cube the 100? I get 10 to the, no. 10 to the 6th, 2 times 3. Raise a power to a power, you multiply. 10 to the 6th. So I take the answer from this and convert it to cubic meters. Then I can go ahead and put the volume in that as cubic meters. The pressure in kPa's, I'll have to put in at thousands of pascals. What do I put in here? Pascals, it says 102. Is that right? 1.2
over atmospheric pressure.
Above atmospheric pressure. But the atmospheric pressure on this side is the same as it is on the other side, right? So actually, as long as we stay on at this level, that's not going to change the amount of pressure I'm pushing. Do I have to overcome atmospheric pressure, or is atmospheric pressure already helping me overcome the resistance of the balloon? You see what I'm saying? So, as long as there's no boundary between me and the atmosphere, that the atmosphere is out of this picture. That's a little tricky. But if I go to put in the pressure as 1.2 kPa, then I have a little problem with that. What I will do is simplify that would be I'd put it as 1.2, and in place of kilo, what power of 10 would I put? What does kilo represent?
1,000.
1,000, so that's 10 to the third pascals. So that's just another way to take 1.2 kilopascals, change it into pascals, and what's another name for pascals? Newton per square meter. Those are the things that drive you crazy. That's hard stuff. You got to know when there's a switch in the name of something. Pascals to newtons per square meter. So 1.2
pascal is 1,000 newtons per square
meter. That's right. A kilopascal is 1,000 newtons per square meter. So I just write the thousands, instead of writing the word kilopascals, I get rid of the kilo, I put in a 10 to the third, and pascals is the same as newtons per square meter, so that's what I have. That's my number of newtons per square meter. This will be my cubic meters, and that will come out to be in units of newtons. Newton meters, that will be joules. So that will come out correct. So again, these problems are marginal. These are not the level of problems that you want to become master at. You want to understand that they all have the same issues. Make the list, do the conversions, try to do the best you can. 14, same thing. So if you get answer for 13, I'll give you the answer. It's going to be about 17 joules. 17 joules for 13. Number 14. Yeah, you should be able to do this one, I think. Notice the they have it in gallons. What do you do if the volume is in gallons? Again, if you're in the metric system, you have to convert it to cubic meters. If you're in the English system, you have to convert it to either cubic inches or cubic feet. This whole problem is in PSI, isn't it?
Yes, it says it right there, 1 gallon equals.
And it tells you how to convert gallons to cubic inches. That's what you look for. You know the units don't match, you look to see, do I have the conversion factor on my sheet, or are they giving it to me in the problem? And in this case, they're giving it to you in the problem. The answer to 14 comes out to be 1136. Mm-hmm. And then 15, they got the volume of the room, but they gave it to you feet by feet by feet. How do you calculate the volume of the room?
Times them.
Yeah, you times them, right? When you know length, width, times height. So you times them, get the volume. Once you know the volume and the pressure difference, you know that work equals volumes times change in pressure. So you should be able to calculate 15. If you do correctly for 15, part A, write the answer down, 14.4 pounds per square foot. Pounds per square foot is what they asked for. B, you have to do a little calculation there because, you know, six times in an hour they change the room air. That means that how many times the volume of the room? Six times, right? If the air is changed six times, that's six volumes. So six times, once you figure that out, you can get the answer to B. B turns out to be, in an hour, the fan does 1.14 times 10 to the 7 foot-pounds. Which would be like 11,400,000. C, you do it in seconds, it comes out 3170 foot-pounds. 3170. 3170. Just converting hours to seconds there. Remember, there's not 60 seconds in an hour. It's 60 seconds in a minute, 60 minutes in an hour. So you got to use the 60 times 60 there, conversion. D, what is the power? Again, that's a little bit above, but based on what we did today, horsepower 550, you'll come out with 5.76. It's dividing 3170 by 550 comes out 5.76. So those last three, I wouldn't stress over them. Do the best you can to, you know, get the information, try to challenge yourself to go to a little higher level with some of these last three a little harder, but I think you all can do it. Do the best you can, and keep in mind that your next assignment is to do 2.3, read and take notes. So if you don't have that somewhere, I tried to produce a new syllabus, but I was having so many problems this morning, I couldn't get it into the printer. So you have to read and take notes on 2.3, work in electrical systems. Okay, we're about ready to go into the lab. Let me just give you a little background. You want to take a break first? Or? One revolution equals 360 degrees equals 2 pi radians, right? That's a
2 pi radius.
The circumference of the circle is 2 pi times the radius.